you?
My name's Bond. James Bond.
Bond. James Bond.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Keeping the British end up, sir.
Welcome to James Bond Radio. News, reviews, and discussion of all things 007.
Pussy.
As you can see, I have no problem with female authority.
Oh, pipe down, 007.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to die.
Hello and welcome to episode 007 of James Bond Radio. What do you think about that, Chris?
Whoa, episode 007. It better be a good one, otherwise our audience will be gutted.
They're just going to switch off immediately, aren't they?
I think so, God. Yeah.
So today we're going to be talking about what some might call the ultimate Bond film, Goldfinger. Da, da, na. So, so Chris, how are you feeling about that, dude?
Yeah, it's good. It's good. It's nice to watch it again and have a look through. There's certainly a lot to talk about. It's probably the most famous Bond film, I'd imagine, known the world over. Like you said, it's pretty much number one for a lot of people out there. So, yeah, this
certainly containing the most iconic scenes, I would say, in most biggest number.
I think that's easily true. You just mentioned the name Goldfinger. You've got straight away. You got the song. You got the villain. You got the henchman. You got the car. You got, you know, Connery probably at his height almost. It's got lots and lots and lots of iconic stuff.
It's all in there, isn't it? It's all in there. So before we get cracking, I just want to say come join us on Facebook. So it's facebook.com/ James Bond Radio, or just put James Bond Radio in the search. Also, what's really handy for us is if you could leave us a review on iTunes. If you just come to the James Bond Radio page on and just put in 5 stars and say how amazing we are, that would be really nice, because that helps us rank higher and we get more listeners and the whole kind of show grows, which is lovely. And then also head on over to jamesbondradio.com and take the ultimate Bond quiz, where we've got 100 questions for you. It's a bonus episode that's not available on iTunes. And Chris or I are kind of testing each other on our Bond knowledge. And we also have a ranking system as well, so you can see how you rank in your fandom. So there we go.
Just make sure you don't end up being Sheriff J.W. Pepper.
Exactly, because he doesn't rank particularly high on J.W. Now, this week we had an email from one of our listeners, Mr. Ian Murdoch, who he'd been listening to our From Russia With Love episode, where you were telling everybody about how you'd been to Istanbul and you'd visited all the locations and stuff. And old Ian, he managed to track down and dragged his missus along to find the Osato Chemical headquarters, which is pretty amazing. And he sent me a little video of him outside, which is amazing. The building looks exactly the same as it did back then. So I'm going to see if I can get him to post the video on Facebook for everyone to check out.
Was that in Tokyo?
Do you know what? I think it probably was. I can't remember exactly where he said it was, but I imagine it was over there. But
wow.
But yeah, but it's cool. It looks exactly the same. So I'll see if I can get him to post it on Facebook and everyone can check it out.
Great. Yeah, I'd like to see that.
So I seem to have some vague memory of you saying you had some sort of erotic dream about Barbara Broccoli or something this week, Chris.
Well, I don't know. It certainly wasn't erotic, but it was an interesting dream. So I thought I'd share it with our lovely James Bond Radio audience. So basically, I haven't really dreamed about Barbara Broccoli before. And for whatever reason, I don't know if we were either on a mission or scouting locations for a film, but it seemed to be that we were on this really old rickety boat. It looked like quite busy traffic, polluted waters. You're probably talking Southeast Asia, a little bit like Man with the Golden Gun, you know, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But the boat stopped, okay? And the driver, the pilot of the boat didn't know how to fix it. So there's me and Babs on this boat. No, like everyone else who's, it must have been location scouting for the film, because everyone else was off and we were trying to radio them to say, right, what are we going to, you know, we can't get there. And then this really little old guy was rowing past, and it was like a big floating polystyrene block. It was like a big, long, rectangular block, wider than maybe half a foot half a foot wide, half a foot high. And it was probably about a 10-meter block. So he was on one end, and he got me and Babs to sit on like sort of the middle or the other end. So we just got this old guy with an oar like paddling us through this like dirty river, sitting on this block of polystyrene, and then we were just discussing locations, and then luckily we ended up in getting to shore, and then we found this really sort of old building with wires hanging everywhere, and Barbara was like, oh wow, this would be perfect, and I was like, oh cool, and then I think I woke up, so that's all it was.
You're fucked up, man. You're fucked up.
I know. I might have had a lot of cheese that night. I think that's probably what it was.
I tell you what, I remember it was the very night we met, actually, at the Ian Fleming Centenary Tribute at the London Palladium. I remember being outside just as some of the kind of the named guests were arriving, because loads of people were there, including Daniel that night, though I didn't see him.
And Rog.
And Rog, of course. And I remember I was just sort of getting to the front door to go in and like give my ticket, and Barbara turns up and she just walks past me, and I remember I had what I'd call a pervy moment where I stood there, and as she walked past me I just got a waft of her, and I just stood there smelling Barbara Broccoli going and then I sort of caught myself of what I was doing. I think, man, that is fucking creepy what you just did. That is really creepy.
Did she catch you?
No, she didn't. She was gone, thankfully.
Shame.
Funny story, actually. You know the TV chef, James Martin? You know the guy that does like Saturday Kitchen? Well, in his autobiography, he used to go out with Barbara Broccoli. I don't know whether you knew this.
Yes. Yeah.
And they basically, he was hired to do like an in-home cooking thing for her birthday or something like that. And I think that's how they met. And it's down to James Martin that Bond had the silver DBS in Casino, because basically she took him along, like when they first gave Daniel the job, they took him along to choose what car they were going to have, and they were going to go with like a more gunmetal color, and James Martin was like, no, Bond has to have a silver Aston Martin, there's no room for discussion there. And then they spent the day on the track like driving around, and like Daniel was test driving the cars and he got to test drive it as well. I mean, I don't think I've ever been more envious of a man in my entire life than I am of James Martin. How about that?
Good choice, though. I mean, I love the DBS in Casino Royale. Yeah. Well, yeah, and I just love DBSs in general. But I mean, yeah, no, it was great. But I did hear as well that, you know, he was in an interview and someone was sort of saying, well, wait a minute, you're going out with like the probably most powerful woman in show business. Mm. You're getting to make decisions about Bond. What happened? And he literally said, it was too much. It was just like a whole other world, you know, where money just wasn't thought about. And it is just such a crazy situation that he just couldn't take it, basically.
No, I think that's understandable as well. I remember him saying that when they went shopping for the cars, like for the movie, he was just sort of like admiring one of them. Like, I think it was probably the DBS, as you would. And she was like, well, let me just buy it for you then. And he's like, no, like, you don't have to fucking buy me things every 5 minutes. And it's like, you know, that's car's an expensive, it's an expensive wagon. And it was just, I think he said he just completely lost his identity and didn't, which again, I suppose is understandable. But
well, I would have handled it all right.
I think, I mean, to be honest, in his shoes, I'd have been fine. Yeah, and that's all right. You, I don't care if I've got an identity or not. Just give me the car. There we go.
Putting your thoughts into future Bond films, though, how cool would that be?
Barbara, if you're listening.
Yeah.
Well, I'm not available because I'm getting married soon, but whatever. Chris, you're available, aren't you, Chris? Yeah.
Well, if Babs is on the market, but I don't think she is. So.
All right. So let's crack on and do a little bit of trivia. It's James Bond trivia time. So I'm going to go first. And my question of the day is Goldfinger related.
Good.
And the question is, what type of golf ball does Goldfinger use?
That is a good one.
It is a very good one.
Is it one that could be crushed easily?
No, that's the beauty of it. It's not crushed easily, but that just exemplifies how strong Oddjob is because he can crush them.
He is awesome.
What do you think about that?
I think
the first of the henchmen who likes to crush things in his palm.
I like it. Dr. No, he wasn't a henchman, but
I was just about to say that. Yeah, but there we go.
Well, there we go. Yeah, cool. So my trivia. Okay, again, Goldfinger related. And my one is, I've taken a leaf out of your book and I've gone for the drink food motif. So mine is, how does Bond take his mint julep?
Okay, I've had a mint julep actually.
Have you? And was it good?
It was very nice. I was on holiday with the missus. We were in New Orleans, and we went to visit one of the old like plantations and stuff to have a look around those old school houses and all that. And they had mint juleps for sale there, and I was like, I've got to have one of those.
I wonder if you ordered it the same way as Bond. Don't tell us, just in case.
All right. Okay. Yeah. All right, and so let's crack on and talk about the movie. So I suppose a good place to start would be to sort of, you know, what were your pre-watching thoughts before you actually watched the film? How did you feel?
I think without a doubt, it just cemented that it is the most iconic Bond film, without a doubt. I mean, you kind of knew that going into it, but that it just cemented, you know, certain things in it are just, well, so recognisable, so iconic. I think my opinion, it hasn't actually changed that much. Prior, like, my opinion for it has changed more from when I was younger to sort of in the last few years. I used to rate it probably as one of my favourites, and it has been my favourite before. Over the last maybe, I don't know, 5, 6, 7 years, it's slowly sort of ebbed away from that top spot. And there's just one or two things that don't quite work for me for that film. Although it's probably got some of the best scenes in the entire series, easily as a whole, it's not quite there for me. It's definitely a great film, it's amazing, and there's so much stuff that goes on well, but I'm still at the same sort of thought that things could have been a little bit better in places.
It's a funny one, isn't it, because that's almost like sacrilege or blasphemy that you said that, because Goldfinger is Goldfinger and it is the most iconic one. But it is a funny one. Like, I think for me it's just I don't know, I'm going to save my thoughts till after we've talked about it, because there's so many things I'm still undecided, if I'm honest, like of how I feel about it. But
I definitely don't hate it. In fact, it is still right up there, but it's just not quite at the peak of
it's a very different type of film than the first two, I think.
Yeah, completely.
But,
yeah.
But I suppose some interesting talking points are the fact that you got a new director for the first time. You got Guy Hamilton coming in. So no Terrence Young this time. Do you know why Terrence didn't come back? What was his problem?
I think it was wanting a certain amount of pay, and the producers thinking, well, not this time.
They were pretty tight-fisted, weren't they? No wonder Babs's got so much money to throw around. So there's that, and the fact that the budget is upped again. It's $3 million in comparison to From Russia with Love's 2 and Doctor Knows 1. So it's just
combined.
You know, it's right up there on in the budget stakes. And that's that. So I guess let's crack on and talk about the very, very first part, which is the gun barrel. And we still have no Connery in the gun barrel. I think that's absolutely astounding that they're still using the Bob Simmons footage, don't you?
And it's the same footage. Like, for all the future Bond gun barrels, they film it for each film. But for the first three, it's the same one, Bob Simmons. But it's not like him doing three different ones. It's exactly the same for the three. Yeah. And it is strange. You would have thought, why not use Sean? I guess perhaps they would think maybe he didn't have the time or whatever. Yeah. But I'm glad they didn't keep it throughout the series.
Yeah, that would have been weird, man. That would have been really weird.
Yeah.
But I suppose the actual pre-title sequence, I mean, it's a cool one, man. It's up there. It's definitely in my top three of best pre-title sequences, without a doubt. You know, you've got the seagull on the head,
which we love.
And then there's just that whole sequence is brilliant. I love the score for that bit. It's more of like a driving score to the Bond theme in this one, where you've got like the part where he's like running along to the tanks and stuff. It's just like, it gets you going, it gets you excited before anything even happens. But I think the cool thing as well is that when he goes inside that tanker, and immediately you think Ken Adam as soon as you see that. It's just, that is a Ken Adam set without any doubt. And he wasn't involved with From Russia, was he, Ken Adam?
He sat
that one out, so it was good to see him back. And then so you've got that whole sequence. He comes back to the bar. Mr. Ramirez is using heroin flavored bananas, which I've recently learned, obviously. And then you've got the belly dancing scene. Now, the belly dancer is Karen Bay's girlfriend. Do you remember that? Karen Bay. That bird, you know, one who found his technique too violent. That's her. It's the same actress. Now, this is the weird thing is, can you imagine that happening today? Can you imagine old Olga Korolenko showing up in Skyfall as a completely different character, and it's not even mentioned, it's not even referred to, it just is. Like, what the hell is that all about?
Yeah, I guess that wouldn't happen. I guess there are two quite small roles, and she was rather sort of hot property in terms of, well, she looks quite good, I think. So, yeah, the thing is, the fact that nobody kind of knew or recognised or had to mention about it meant that it was a good choice, I think, you know. Didn't distract from the film, did it? You didn't suddenly go, oh, what is she doing there, sort of thing. Yeah. So, yeah, I think it was all right. If it had been Honor Blackman suddenly doing a little role in Thunderball, you would have probably gone, what's
that
going on?
True.
But, yeah. So I think it was all right.
I guess it's just an example of something that just would never happen today.
No, that's
but,
true.
But it's funny. And I, to be honest, I didn't notice that until recently. I was like, that is the same woman, isn't it? but there we go. So how did your rating of the opening sequence fall? What do you think?
Yeah, for me, I totally agree with you. I think it has to be top three. It's the first sort of mini movie. I love From Russia with Love's pre-title, but that was kind of connected to the film. Goldfinger's, it's its own little movie in one. And you've got a little bit of sort of action. You've got a little bit of romance. You've got the fighting. You've got the sort of good dialogue. Obviously, you've got the brilliant bit, like we mentioned, with the duck and he's scuba diving. Plants of bombs, comes out, takes off the dry suit in like his white dinner jacket, puts the little carnation in. That is the coolest thing anyone has ever seen.
I think,
ever.
I think you're right. I think that is
ever.
That is the iconic moment at the beginning, isn't it? I mean, just the carnation, taking it off. He's got the white jacket on. I mean, that you just don't beat that, do you?
You can't. And Sean Connery, like, he's just oozes sort of charisma when he's doing it. And then, like you said, obviously go in, you got the I like the little dialogue between him and the other agent who sort of warns him, and the way when the bomb goes off as well, when he just casually like, oh, what was that, and then he just swaggers in, and total core.
I want to know the backstory, in the sense that, like, there he is, he's meeting his contacts at the bar, and he's, you know, he's just hanging out and chatting, and everybody's going ape shit in the background,
yeah,
and then he's like, right, I've got some unfinished business to attend to. And then he just goes in the back room, just fucking like takes off his jacket, and he just starts macking out on the girl. And it just does make me laugh. I just think it's hilarious just how, like, when you look at it, how awful it is, really. Like, just how he's just grabbing her and he's fucking macking out. And then he sort of looks back and you see the guy approaching in her eyeballs. Just spins around, so she gets clubbed around the head instead of him. Like, he just does not give a shit, does he, about anybody or anything. I think it's hilarious.
I think he must have known already that she was a baddie. I think he must have known he's going back, but he's still going to have his fun, and even more so because he knows that, you know, she's a bit of a villainess, so he can do what he likes. So I think he already had that in mind. Obviously, he might not have known. He didn't know the guy was about to hit him, but I think, you know, anything could have happened, and he, like you said, he wouldn't have given a shit, because I think he knew she was dodgy but still wanted to have his fun.
He was going to go in there, have a quick route, and then sort the problem out.
There's a couple of cool little things about that as well. The guy who played the sort of the guy who he fought, Capungo, the character's name was, the guy who originally was signed up to play him was a cat burglar. that was like his profession, I guess. and he was basically caught cat burglaring like the night before or something, and put in prison.
So he's out stealing cats.
Yeah, I think he is. Yeah, he's got a load of them. He's got a warehouse full of meow going on.
That sounds like a Bond villain right there.
Right, that's it. Bond 24.
Yeah,
I reckon. Yeah, so they basically went to this stunt guy, Alf Joint, and said, "Right, so you've got the job." And he was a bit like, "What job?" And they're like, "Oh, you're going to play the cat burglar, or not? What is he? He's not a cat burglar. You're going to play the sort of thug."
The thug, yeah.
Yeah, because he had a high cheekbone, so they said he could end up look kind of Mexican or South American. Mm. So he's like, "Oh, okay." So, yeah, that's a bit of an interesting little thing about it.
Nicely done. Yeah.
Yeah. I wonder if cat burglar was on his CV. This guy.
Again, that's another product of a time gone by, isn't it? I mean, like, how often do you hear about cat burglars these days? But I imagine he would have been, you know, when he'd go into work, he'd have a black suit on.
Yeah.
You know,
swag bag.
Yeah, a swag bag, and he'd, you know, he'd be cutting holes in windows and
and have those little things over his eyes, the little eye.
So I suppose after that, you've got shocking, positively shocking. And then, dan, dan. And you've got probably one of, if not the most iconic title sequence of them all. Now, something I've learned from watching these movies through again, and like I say, I'm trying to watch them through with fresh eyes and like pretending I haven't seen them and looking at them from the perspective that I'd never watched them before. I've given old Morris Binder like all the props for all the title sequences, but he didn't even do Goldfinger. It was Robert Brown John again, who I'd never heard of until we started doing these podcasts. So it's pretty mental that he's the one that sort of gets all the kudos, whereas Brown John is responsible for the majority of the early films.
Yeah, no, I completely agree as well. And I heard somewhere that the Goldfinger credit, the Goldfinger titles, Robert the Brown John did was kind of based on sort of Morris Binder and Dr. No, but it wasn't. Morris Binder's one in Dr. No was great, had all the colours, but he didn't have like the sort of, he had the dancers, but he didn't have the women shown as they were in From Russia with Love and Goldfinger.
Yeah.
And it's done so well. And again, he deserves so much more credit than perhaps he's been given, because without it, who's to say that from Thunderball onwards, we might not have seen the sort of women how we did with Binder. So, yeah. And I love those credits as well, because, well, they're classy. You've got the Golden Girl and the projected images from the film.
Yeah.
And, you know, it's just, it works, I think. It works really well. And there's a couple of cool little bits as well where they show a quick shot from Russia with Love,
which wasn't used.
Yeah. And apparently there's a shot of Dr. No's base exploding, which I remember an explosion, but I didn't sort of...
Sometimes it's quite hard to make out what's actually... Because obviously it's projected onto the body of the girl. I think it's a great title sequence and a great song, as we've previously discussed. Yeah.
I think for me, it's the best lyrical Bond song, like the best song with lyrics with a voice. In case anyone didn't quite understand what I meant,
there's a pretty broad spectrum there. But yeah, I like it.
No, because basically, Honor Majesty's is my favourite, but obviously that's.
Oh, I can't wait to talk about Honor Majesty's.
I know.
All right, let's not get too excited.
No, but Bassie's song for me is the best sort of one. But there is one cool bit with the titles, which I think definitely deserves a mention. There's one shot where you see a golf ball being putted, and it neatly goes into a hole in one down the girl's cleavage, which is kind of nice, I think, and purposefully done as well.
Now, speaking of cleavage, one interesting thing that I only learnt about last night as I was rewatching the extras on the Blu-ray is the golden girl in the title sequence is actually Dink, who everybody will remember from Miami, which I didn't know about that. And Dink was a model at the time. Anybody who's interested in doing any further research, you can find posing in various gentlemen's magazines and stuff from the era, which is great. And that's certainly something I would do. I wouldn't look at things like that. But
I thought that's the research you were doing all last night.
No. I've got an image to protect. Okay. Chris, come on, man.
Okay.
And there she was. And I didn't realize she was the golden girl as well in the title sequence, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, good old Margaret Nolan.
Yeah, there she is. So after that, we get taken to Bond in Miami, his first trip to the States. So we get Felix, the new Felix. How do you feel about, I don't know how you say this name, is it Czech or Cease?
I've heard Cease, Linda. I think it's Cease.
I heard his casting was deliberate to sort of like make Felix less cool, because Lord in Dr. No was the big name at the time.
That's what I heard. Yeah. And I heard that from a sort of a close friend of ours. And I actually listened in a documentary. And again, it was a case that Jack Lord wanted more money. And they were just like, well, no. So we're going to bring in someone else. So maybe it's a combination of the two. I don't know. But although Cease Linder, he's not as cool. He's not as good as Jack Lord. And for me, he's definitely not one of the better lighters. He's still not the worst. There's still good chemistry there. You know, I don't think he's too bad. He's
all right. He's a functional Felix.
Exactly.
But I think, again, like talking about how sort of sexist it was, and again, product of the times, you've just got to love that part where Dink is giving Bond a massage. Felix arrives. He jumps up and he's just like, say hello to Felix. Say goodbye to Felix. Man talk. Spank. And off she goes. Never to be seen again. That's the last we see of Dean. Just completely discarded from Bond's life.
With a nice slap on the ass.
But I think what deserves a special mention, and I think this might even be my favourite part of the entire Bond series, is that amazing blue terry cloth onesie that he wears. I mean, I want one of those. And I've actually combed the internet to see if you can buy them, and they're not to be found anywhere.
Really?
And I would wear one of those all the time around the house and even out and about on the warmer days if I had one of those.
And would you still have a missus if that was the case?
Maybe not. Maybe not. I don't know. I think she's reasonably understanding with these sorts of things. So I think she'd allow it on occasion.
Right. But, one birthday, I'll get one and it'll randomly appear on your door. You'll open it up and you'll be like,
My life is complete. I've already got my replica Daniel Craig swimming shorts from Casino.
So, which you could wear underneath them, and then you could...
Is true. Yeah. Maybe that'll be my next costume for a future episode. I'll just be sat here in my little chuddies.
It's an interesting sort of thing. I think if anyone could pull it off, it'd be Connery. And with even then, it's all right. It's all right. It's questionable. But
I tell you who I can't imagine in it is old Dalton. I can't imagine Dalton. You picture that man in the blue terry coat. It just doesn't work.
No, not at all. Not at all. The Miami scene is good. See, I like the intro music as well. I mean, Barry's score for this is great, but I like the whole intro music and the good shot where it swoops in and you get the dive and then it goes underwater and you see lights. That's all really nice. It does seem to be a bit ruined by, there's quite a lot of back projection. Mm. There's quite a lot of editing between set and location and like plates. And I know you can only do with what you've got. And obviously technology back then isn't as good as it is now with what you can do. But it is a little bit distracting when it is quite obvious that it's not quite there, you know.
Well, I heard that
it's a shame because I know Guy Hamilton wasn't happy, but
because Cease was the only one who actually was in Miami, wasn't he? Connery never set foot in the States during the whole filming of it, so it's kind of they get the shots of him walking by the pool with all the backdrop of the hotel, and that was the only bits that they had. And then when everybody else came on board, it was back projection and stuff. But there's an interesting little throwaway line where he says to Felix, they got a lot closer to you in Jamaica, didn't they? So it's a little throwaway reference to
that. That's a good point. Yeah. I remember that line now. Yeah, that's a really good point. And it's nice. I like those little links. It's good. I really
do. It is good. Yeah. I mean, the world of Bond and continuity is a little bit sort of weak in a lot of places, but it's cool. I like it when they sort of just refer back a little bit to the older movies.
In fact, I think we will have to do a podcast completely towards Bond continuity, the good parts and the bad parts at one point. That'd be quite interesting.
And maybe we should just do the episode completely jumbled up as a tribute to that.
And get the audience to try and work out what's going on. Yeah
start with the goodbyes and end with the hellos. So it's during this scene that we first meet Goldfinger. He's strolling down the little stairs to go into his card game. Now, one of the interesting things about this is that I don't know if this is true, and I certainly couldn't tell from watching it last night, is that one of the things is this movie, there's no mention of Blofeld or Spectre, and one is led to believe that Goldfinger is his own independent villain. But some say you can see Goldfinger wearing a Spectre ring during the card game. Now, what are your thoughts on that? Did you manage to spot that or not?
I've heard of this before, and it's the first time that I actually tried physically to look. So I watched the scene, I went back, I was like, right, I watched the whole film, and then I went back, and I was like, watch that scene, and I paused. And these weren't on the Blu-ray, so they're the sort of normal DVD, special edition DVDs or whatever they are, ultimate edition DVDs. And he's got the ring on, and it's on the right finger. It might be on the right finger, and it's a big gold ring. And inside it, like the actual main part, with the Spectre ring before, it was kind of white with a black octopus or whatever. Or in fact, in From Russia with Love, I think it was black all over, but you could see the octopus. With this, I couldn't tell. Like, I paused it. You get to see it quite look. It definitely isn't an exact sort of copy in terms of style of the supposed Spectre ring. So I thought, well, maybe he's got his own version. But I even pausing and having a look, I really couldn't tell. So I think you should have a look on the Blu-ray, get it up close and see. But in all honesty, I don't think it was. But
I think let's throw that out to the listeners. I think if everyone goes and has a look and see what they think, and let us know on the Facebook page whether they agree that it's a Spectre ring. Personally, my gut feeling is that Goldfinger is far too greedy to be involved in a Spectre like organization. He wants all the gold for himself. He's not going to be financing, you know, anything like that.
No, I completely agree. And the fact it's not mentioned, and exactly, that's a perfect point. He wouldn't want anyone else to come anywhere near his gold. But,
he's a greedy bastard. He is, isn't he?
But that's what makes him great. I think
one of the things as well is the next scene, which is just, again, you've got to give kudos to this. There've been so many iconic scenes throughout the first three films, but I think this is probably the most iconic scene, which is obviously Shirley Eaton as the golden girl. Before we get to that, when he goes into a Goldfinger suite and there she is on the balcony and stuff, and he goes through that whole, card game shenanigans and making him lose and all that kind of stuff, which is a recurring theme with Fleming's villains, isn't it? He loves his villains to cheat at sports or games or whatever.
And obviously he does it later on with the golf as well. It's good. I really like that.
But do you think that was a little bit irresponsible of Bond in the sense that he's made Goldfinger lose at cards? And instead of being like, right, well, let's take old Jilly and let's go back to my room and get the job done, he's just ends up boning her in Goldfinger's suite. So in my mind, there's more than enough time passed there for Goldfinger to finish his card game, come back to the suite. I think it was a bit too risky, don't you think?
Yeah, I guess just hanging out in his suite is a little bit too pushing it a bit far. Yeah. And then it's set up a great bit. Like, I love it when Oddjob comes in and like chops him down, and then you hear the ding ding ding.
I was going to say that there's that musical cue, isn't
there? It's like, so great.
Yeah, that is wicked. I like that.
Yeah, it's brilliant, and that's basically like Oddjob's music. Whenever you hear it or see him, you hear it, and it links well, and it adds that little bit of fright because you're like, crikey. And there's a funny bit as well. I heard that when Oddjob went and sort of quite chopped Sean Connery, he didn't quite have the skill to sort of pull his punch or whatever. And apparently Connery still feels the effects of that to this day.
Yeah. Well, he was a wrestler, wasn't he, Harold Sakata?
Yeah,
he like won
a
silver medal at the Olympics, I think, for wrestling. Yeah. So he was a genuinely tough dude.
Yeah.
There's a really funny, actually, because obviously Oddjob defined his whole career, and he used to appear as Oddjob in loads of different things. And there was an advert for cough syrup. I don't know whether you've seen this.
Yeah.
Vicks 44, I think it was called. And basically he's just trotting about as Oddjob, coughing and sneezing. But as he's doing it, he's like karate chopping things. So like he'll go to knock on a door and like sneeze and end up karate chopping the door and the door will fall apart. And then Mrs. Oddjob comes out and gives him a spoon of medicine. And then they look out at the garden, and like the whole street outside the house is just completely destroyed. Where he's been coughing and sneezing everywhere, which I think is hilarious.
I like that. It's good.
Yeah. It's up on YouTube.
Yeah.
But next up, after Bond's been knocked out and left, and we've got the Golden Girl. I mean, that is just a vision, isn't it? And I mean, I think overall, like, the difference between From Russia with Love and this is huge in the sense of like the first two films for me feel like they're still a product of the 50s. Mm-hmm. They don't feel like swinging 60s. Whereas as soon as we hit Goldfinger, which is only a year later, it's full on swinging 60s. You know, it's Austin Powers world. Like as soon as you see that pool scene at Miami, it's like everybody's in bikinis running around, jumping in the pool. And I mean, it's just in full flight. So I don't know. I almost feel like, you know, your Beatles can sod off. It was like Bond who was responsible for that cultural revolution. That's my take on it. Anyway, what do you think about that?
Yeah, I mean, the Goldfinger album outplayed the Beatles album anyway, which is pretty cool, I think. Yeah. It's great, and that scene as well with Shirley Eaton. Something I noticed when I was watching it last night is everything in that suite, which you'd expect as it's Goldfinger suite, is gold or gold-coloured related. Yeah. You've got the bed posts, you've got the lamp, you've got the picture frames, you've got the wallpaper, whatever it is, you've got like the cup holders, you've got like a vase, and everything is like gold or a hint of gold. The pillowcases are sort of yellow, you know, a light yellow, almost golden color. And, and it's just cool the way that they sort of obviously on purpose added all those elements. And then when the light comes on and you see Shirley Eaton, and it's just everything glows, the whole screen just glistens, and it's what a scene.
It's pretty mental, isn't it? It's cool. I mean, I don't think there is a more, with the exception of honey coming out of the water, I don't think there is a more iconic scene in all of cinema, actually. Cinema. But so after that, we're back in London, and one of my favorite lines from M, which is, "You were supposed to observe Goldfinger, not borrow his girlfriend," which I think is brilliant.
Yeah, I like that. It's very good, and rightly so from M's point of view as well, I guess.
So we're going through that sequence, and then we've got, you know, the trip to the Bank of England, and we have
a brilliant Bond
around the table and stuff, which is great. Yeah, there's another thing. I mean, Bond has gone into cocky overdrive in this movie, I think. Like, just everything that comes out of his mouth is a smart comment. And there's the bit where the manager of the Bank of England's like, "Oh, I'll have another bit of this rather disappointing brandy." And then Bond's, and M's like, "Oh, what's wrong with it?" And Bond's like, "Well, I'd say it was a 30-year-old indifferently blended, sir, with an overdose of Bon Bois." How do you indifferently blend a brandy? And what is Bon Bois?
It's only something that a connoisseur like Bond would know, I guess. It's a good. You can see that M's reaction to that is kind of, he's not very. He's been put down a little bit, so to speak, without Bond possibly meaning to be nasty. But he gets his comeuppance. M gets his own back on Bond. There's obviously at the end of the scene where Bond goes to grab the bar of gold, and M's like, you'll retrieve it from Q Branch with the rest of your gadgets. And then he sits back smugly holding the brandy still, and just like, he knows he's put Bond in his place. I really like that. It's a good exchange.
That is cool. I think after that as well, I suppose this is our first proper look at Q Branch, isn't it? Like the Q lab as such.
Q lab,
You know, with all the different bits and bobs kind of going off in the background and all the different bits, which I think is just magical. I think it's great.
I mean, that must have been in the script already, like the Q Branch. So I don't know if it must have been, I guess, May Baum and Paul Dane, who wrote the script as well, must have sort of had that idea, because I don't know, in the Fleming books, obviously, in terms of the gadgets, did they have things like a Q Branch lab in the Fleming books? Do you know?
I remember him being referred to as Boothroyd, but I don't remember there being real sort of like gadgets being a major feature of the books. I'm sure the attaché case was in From Russia with Love, but I don't remember there being a lot of gadgety things in the books, which is quite funny, really, when you think about it.
So it's definitely like that element that's come along with the films is obviously grown and is a staple. But yeah, great to see it. You know, you've got the gas parking meter, you've got the bulletproof coat going off, and it's not perfected yet, and all this going on. And then you've got the most you know.
Well, I mean, one thing I thought was quite funny is that until now, like Q or Boothroyd and Bond had been good to each other, they sort of got on well, but it was Guy Hamilton's idea was for Q to be like, to not like Bond very much because he didn't appreciate his work, and Desmond has said before, like, he originally played that scene as if he admired Bond and like it was like, here's 007, you know, and Guy Hamilton was like, no, this guy gives you no respect whatsoever, you need to dislike him. And then of course from that movie on, there's that whole dynamic in their relationship, which I thought was quite cool.
I think Guy Hamilton actually brought a lot to the series. Obviously, Terence Young, everyone knows about, set the tone, set the style for Bond. But with Goldfinger, Guy Hamilton put one or two different things into the sort of Bond formula, which has obviously stayed to this day. So he definitely deserves a lot of credit as well for that. So yeah, great.
And it was his idea for the revolving number plates as well. Yeah. The DB5.
That's right. Yeah, and how do you know how he got that idea?
He'd got too many parking tickets or something, wasn't it? Or something like that.
That's a great idea. I still think to myself, like, now I remember coming up with some Bond ideas. I like coming up with like ideas for Bond films and stuff. And one of them was, I think it was an Aston at the time. And instead of a revolving number plate, it was basically a digital plate. So he had like his yellow, British yellow number plate with the thing. And then you press a button and then it would digitally move and then come back again. And I think that'd be quite cool. I'd love if they brought that back for like the next Bond car, just as a nice, you know,
just little nod.
Yeah, exactly. That'd be cool. Yeah, so if you're listening, again, Babs, there you go.
But I think, I suppose this, again, this is another iconic moment. The first time we see the DB5, you know, Bond comes in, he's like, where's my Bentley? And he's like, oh, no, we've got something else for you this time. Yeah. And then you've got the DB5, which is just, I mean, I don't think there is a more beautiful object on this planet than a DB5. I mean, it's just amazing.
It looks amazing. Like you said, this sort of colour we mentioned before. The line, you know, it's just smooth. It looks good. And it is just so associated with Bond now. And it's just such a lovely car to look at. And obviously it's even better when we find out what's inside it and everything like that.
Now, here's a question. You know, Bond goes to him, you'd be surprised the amount of wear and tear that goes on there out there in the field.
Yeah.
Where is this field, Bond's hanging out all the time?
It's a bit of a dirty field. It must a lot of rough stuff goes on there. So
if all of his wear and tear comes from this field, because it's the field, you know, so it must be a specific one.
I think
like,
so.
Well, you know, what's he doing hanging out in a field so much? I don't get it.
Maybe if he went to the next door field, things would be a lot easier. So I don't know. We'll put that out to him just in case. Yeah.
So Bond's gone in to see Q. He's got his car. He's got his bits and bobs. He's picked up his gold brick, obviously. Mm-hmm. Which takes us on to another iconic scene, which is the golf game.
So good.
I mean, this is the moment, isn't it? I mean, this is what gave Sean Connery his lifetime love of golf is learning to play for this scene. Now, how do you say this? Because I always thought it was Stoke Pokes, but is it Stoke
Poges? I think
Poges.
Stoke Poges.
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, which apparently is only, you know, a couple of miles down the road from Pinewood, which was quite handy.
Yeah.
But I think what they did well there. I mean, this is definitely one of the best scenes in the film. And, you know, golf has a lot of fans around the world and, you know, everyone's into their sports. But it also has a lot of people that would never, in their right mind, think about watching a golf game. Mm. And the fact that they've created a scene which is entertaining, you know, clever, it's funny, it works well. It says you're getting a lot across about the characters all while they're playing golf that anyone could watch and take in. That's a hard skill to do. And I think they've done it so well with this scene.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting that, isn't it? Because it's the same with the card game in Casino in the sense that it's like, how do you make a card game exciting? And they do, and they pull it off. And that could easily have been a part in Casino where the movie sort of dipped in energy, but they managed to keep it up. And again, something that's sort of, you know, boring to watch as golf, they really keep up the tension and the flow of it and the pace. It's great.
I love the way that when early on, when Bond first drops that bar of gold to put Goldfinger, the putt's like, what, I don't know, 8 inches, 10 inches or something. It's a tiny putt.
Yeah.
And yet this bar of gold just glistens in the sun. And it's brilliant. It's a lovely little bit, that. It's great.
Yeah, and just misses the hole. But
So,
and then you've got that whole bit again. Goldfinger's cheating again because he likes to win. Yeah. I wonder how long it took old Harold to learn his words for this movie.
It did do well, though, to be fair.
you got the bit where Goldfinger ends up in the rough. Oh, bad luck, you're in the rough.
Yeah, that's a nice line.
And that whole exchange, again, and that's a great way to pick up the tension, you know, Bond standing on his ball.
That's his original ball, I'm Arnold Palmer.
you should have saved that for the quote round.
Oh, damn.
That was a great performance.
Next time.
And you've got that part where, you know, he's like, oh, it isn't, I'm standing on it. And then Goldfinger, obviously our job, does the ball down the trouser leg trick. And then, Bond switches the balls around at the next hole. And then there's that moment where Goldfinger is about to tee off and then the ball falls off the tee and then he comes and picks it up. And it's, you know, it's very, you know, and Bond's even so perturbed, he actually just puts his hand on his little, what's his name, that guy, the caddy?
Hawker,
that's it.
Yeah.
Puts his hand on Hawker and he's like, after he tees off, which I think is great.
Yeah. And I like the way as well, just a little thing, like the last 18th hole, Bond was meant to go first, but Goldfinger went first. And Hawker sort of said, oh, it's your runner, sir. And Bond was like, no, it's all right. Anything, he didn't want to put him off. He was like, you know, let's just catch this guy.
Yeah,
and the fact that you got Oh, we better not mention this. I didn't know if it was one of the quote questions. No, all right, we won't go there.
Yeah, no, that was my trivia question. Yeah, you nearly spoiled it.
We won't go there then. No, we'll talk about that later. But yeah, it was great. And then obviously Bond knows that he's got him where he wants him. And then you're down to the last part in the hole. And you can see Bond's just, oh well, okay, Goldfinger, you win. Here's the gold bar, whatever. Oh, wait a minute. And then... yeah, so good. So good.
Yeah, we are playing strip balls of golf, so I'm afraid you lose the hole and the match, and then golfing is not happy, is he?
Nah, he's not happy, and rightly so. And then we got other sort of basically. Well, we've got two kind of iconic things coming up next as well. Still at Stoke Poges, so we've got Bonds. We see him use a homer, so he chucks a homer, sticks it under the back of the Phantom III's boot, which is really mm-hmm. nice. But he still has a little joke, and I love the way that the dialogue between them is so sort of candid and sort of generalized, but with intent behind it. So that they're both fully aware of the other person and what's going on. But it's not like they can say, "Right, I'm going to kick your ass." No, fuck you, I'm going to kick your ass. It's obviously
that would be a great exchange. I'm going to kick your ass. God, forget that. I'm going to kick your ass on.
So it's done obviously a lot more subtle than that. But it's just so well done. And then obviously Bond's like, "Oh, I believe this is your." Oh no! First of all, before that, then we got Goldfinger sort of saying, "Right, this is that you've last time you're going to go into my affairs, or something like this, and then calls up odd job." And
I think for Bond 24, man, when John Logan's finished, I reckon they should send it to you for a dialogue polish, like, so you can just get some cool dialogue.
Yeah. Odd job, I'm gonna kick your butt. But the whole hat thing is brilliant. First time you see it, chops off the statue head. It's formidable weapon. This guy, you already see, he's a pretty stocky bloke. You know he's chopped Bonds. Would you happily say that it was Oddjob that painted Shirley Eaton gold to kill her?
I think it must have been.
I think it would have to be, yeah.
Yeah.
So, he's already killed one and whatever, done some damage. And now, he's got this weapon as well. It's like, shit. And then you can see how strong he is again when Bond sort of gives him the golf ball. And
yeah, does the old crushy. Yeah.
Good stuff. I think there was actually Sean Connery was a bit upset at that scene because he basically said that it was so ridiculous that no one in the world could crush a golf ball, that he didn't want it in the film. And Guy Hamilton had to explain the very reason that no one in the world can crush a golf ball is why it needs to be in there, because you want to see Oddjob doing it, because that at one point later in this film, you're going to have to face this guy. And if you know that he can do that, you're not going to be in for a very good time, sort of thing. And then obviously, it was right, sort of thing.
Absolutely. But, I think that was definitely a good choice. It shows how formidable he's got the hat. He's got the super powered hat, and he can crush golf balls in his hands. It's going to be a tough fight when that comes up. Yeah.
Definitely. So
following that, we've got the homing device in Goldfinger's boot. And then I think we've got some of the most beautiful cinematography, certainly that was echoed in Skyfall on the trip up to Scotland. Is the drive through the Swiss mountains while he's tailing him. Bond's got his in-car GPS or sat-nav kind of tailing him, which I think, isn't that incredible how, like, that's 1964 and that wasn't even a thing. Yeah. And there it is. It's a staple in everybody's car these days.
And now everyone can stop off for a quick one on route.
So. Exactly. Yeah. And then, so you've got the kind of, you've got the exchange with Tilly, Jilly's sister.
Yeah.
She shows up. Now, one of the things I sort of found with that is, again, you've got something else iconic, which is the spikes that come out of the wheels and mince up the car and all the rest of it. And then when they've crossed paths again, it's like Goldfinger gets out on that little sort of mountain road corner.
I love that three sort of height difference of the roads. Yeah, it's great.
We need to track down that stretch of road.
I know, it's called the Furka Pass.
Oh, yeah? Okay.
And we will go there. We'll go there. It's cool.
Now, one thing that confused me a little bit is, Bond gets up and he's on the higher level and he's sort of just watching him, gets out of his car and keeps an eye on him. And then Tilly is a level up again. She's got a rifle. She's going to try and shoot Goldfinger. Obviously, she misses, ricochets off the ground next to Bond. He jumps behind the car. But then when Oddjob gets back in the car, he sort of looks up and grins. and then gets in the car and drives on. Yeah. Now, what's that all about? Because it was almost like that sort of would lead to believe that Oddjob organized, like Newbon was there and he organized somebody to try and kill him, and that's him going, ah, there's the gunshot. That's been done. And then he gets in the car. I don't know what that's all about. What
no, I never thought of it that way. I always thought, well, Tilly's just a shit shot. So she's basically aiming for Goldfinger, almost hits Bond. And so that's kind of her deal. Yeah. And when Oddjob looks up and smiles, I always thought that he knew that Bond was tracking them. And it was almost like, yeah, we thought he'd still be following us, and that just proved our thought right, rather than him sort of having employed someone to try and
I guess after that exchange at the golf club, you would just assume that he's on your tail still, wouldn't
yeah.
you?
Yeah.
Even though, you know, you wouldn't need the tracker so much to assume that, I suppose. Yeah, that makes sense.
And I also really like the way that we see Goldfinger here, like, very like normal. So you've got this big villain, but you see him like in the back of the car just sort of sniveling. Then they stop off and they buy some fruit from these random little fruit sellers on the corner of the road, just eating. Yeah. And there's something about that, you know. We don't always have to see them with a big laser or, you know, in their private plane. We can see them just on the side of the road doing these sort of simple things.
I want more of that, dude. I want to see the next Bond villain be like, oh, I need a dump, and off he goes to the bathroom. I want to see the regular lives of Bond villains, you know. That's what I want.
Yeah, okay, there we go. Bond 24 is pretty much written. We've done it already.
Dude, Logan, when you're finished, mate, because I know you're a listener, we want Chris to do a little dialogue polish. He's got some great ideas, and I've got some ideas I want to throw in as well. All right, good
great.
Stuff.
Excellent.
There was a funny old story actually from Guy Hamilton about this sequence, in the sense that he, after the movie came out, he got a letter from a fan that said, Dear Mr. Hamilton, when the DB5 leaves Switzerland, the back tyres of the car are Pirelli CXXY tyres. But when he arrives at the petrol station, they're Dunlop 402s. Yours sincerely, Roger Brown, age 9. Now, again, imagine, like, obviously you wrote a letter to Babs and Michael that was rudely rebuffed and never responded to or even acknowledged. Imagine writing to the director of Goldfinger as a 9-year-old boy and actually getting a response, which is what he did. Awesome. And this was Guy Hamilton's response. Dear Roger, well done. You spotted one of our 6 deliberate mistakes. If you can spot the other 5, you're invited to Pinewood to have lunch with James Bond. Now, imagine if you got that letter, how, like, apeshit you would go. I would go apeshit now as a 31-year-old man, let alone a 9-year-old boy. Guy was thinking that he was hoping that the kid and all his mates would, like, go and watch Goldfinger another 10 times to sort of, like, bump up the ticket takings.
Which clever was quite, idea. Clever was idea. Cool. Yeah, I like that. It's good.
Yeah, but it's got a funny story. Yeah.
Yeah. The bit as well, what do you think about, obviously, I like the little... Like we said, the scenery is good, and I like the little car chase with the Mustang and the DB5. And then when Bond sort of uses the tire slashers, like, you know, the car ends up going down a ditch sort of thing. Mm. It could have been a lot worse. If he's just, like, blown 2 tires, the car, you know, that could have, I don't know, flipped or hit something. You know, she could have easily died.
She could have died. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. And Bond was just like, you know, well... Again, he didn't really care. You know, I guess he thought she'd try to kill him. And, you know, and I guess rightly so, he was going to try and sort her out sort of thing. But
yeah.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah, it's interesting. So next up, you're at the part where Bond's up on the hill and he's kind of observing the Goldfinger's kind of factory or base or whatever you want to call it.
I love this bit. I love it. The music is fantastic. We're seeing Bond spying again, you know. Mm. So it's lovely to see him sneak around and do spying stuff. I just love it. I love it. I want to see more of that. I really do.
That's the thing. Especially in the later films, it can be seen as Bond as just this sort of all-out action hero. And that's not what he's meant to be. No. Like, there's nothing that excites me more than sneakiness. I just love it.
Sneakiness is good. Dressed, like, in black, using the shadows, climbing up the little ladders.
You know, he's got his tracksuit on. He's ready for a little bit of, you know, reconnaissance or whatever you want to call it.
Yeah.
And I think that's brilliant. Yeah, no, it's great. There he is, observing it from above. He's got his old binoculars out and he's kind of checking it all out. But then for me, I think as you sort of go through it, you realize, and I've said this before, in this movie, you realise just how sort of inept Bond is in this film. He doesn't really do much of value throughout the entire thing. So if you imagine so far throughout the movie, you know, he's come into contact with Jill, and through his own sort of, you know, lack of respect for what the situation, he's boning her in Goldfinger's suite, and she ends up dead, and he ends up, you know, knocked out by Oddjob. And then he comes in, meets her sister, and then obviously they cross paths. She's up in the hills, and she's about to try and shoot Goldfinger herself. He stops her. The gun sets off the tripwire, and then there's the whole chase sequence. And of course, Tilly ends up dead by Goldfinger by Oddjob's hat. So that's two girls he's come into contact with now who've died from his negligence, if you will. And then obviously Bond's trying to escape, and he gets caught himself, and he ends up strapped to the table with the laser. Now, this isn't Bond's finest hour, is it? I know he was a bit slippy with Red Grant on the train.
Yeah.
But this is sort of like a new level of slovenliness, wouldn't you say?
I think it's probably, from a success point of view, the worst that Bond has been in terms of, you know, in terms of what he's actually done. Because obviously, you know, later on as well, he's put in a cell, he gets out, then he gets caught again, and he's put back in a cell. And then, you know, it is a strange one, because everyone thinks, like we say, sort of say, of Goldfinger being amazing, and it is, and there's so much good stuff. But the whole character of Bond in this, there's something to be said about him not being quite on the money.
He's not on the ball in this movie.
He's not. Strange, isn't it?
It is odd.
Yeah, but I mean, back to the sort of factory bit. I like the fact that when he's sneaking around, we get to hear him. We get to see him watch Goldfinger and Ling, seeing him how he transports the gold by smouldering it and then putting it into the body work of his Rolls Royce. I thought that was really clever and really good. And obviously he hears Operation Grand Slam, which is vital to it later on, and that's great. Then he goes up in the forest, and he's there with Tilly. Now, there is one thing about this scene which grates me every time I see it. And when he's with Tilly and they're rolling around after the hitting the wire, for me, this is possibly the worst acting I've ever seen in the whole Bond series, when she's going, "Ah, you're breaking my back. Ah, it hurts," and all this, and like, "Let go, and I want to kill him. Goldfinger, he killed my sister.
I want to kill him. Yeah.
And for me, it's terrible acting. I know she's not an actress, she was a model. And some of the other scenes is not too bad. The scene where they're in the car driving along, like in the Aston and stuff to the garage, is fine. But that bit, oh, I hate it. I really do. It's just bad acting.
She auditioned for the role of Tanya from Russia. So no wonder she didn't get the role with chops like that.
Yeah. I'm really glad she didn't. Yeah, it was. Yeah. I just thought I had to mention it just because it wasn't great. Yeah. But obviously the car chase then makes up for it. The car chase is very good. You know, you've got the chase for the woods. You've got the smoke screen, the oil slick. You've got the rear bulletproof screen and then Bond firing and stuff, so that's all good. But it gets better when I love the bit, and this is something we can talk about in a second, when he's caught and they're brought back to Oryk Enterprises factory, and there's the little old lady that opens the gate to let him in. Obviously, flies off ejector seat. The guy's gone driving around, and then she's there with the like Sten machine gun firing at his windshield. I thought that was brilliant. And apparently, like Guy Hamilton was saying, that he met up with Alfred Hitchcock not long afterwards, who'd seen the movie, and they were having lunch. And throughout the whole lunch, he didn't say anything whatsoever about Goldfinger. And then at the very end, he turned back to Guy Hamilton, sort of said, "That bit with the old lady and the machine gun, I wish I did that." And then he just walked off, and like the only bit of praise, but that's kind of cool, I think.
Nice. I like that. That's cool. Yeah. So I suppose that leads us. In fact, you went to one of those Pinewood things, didn't you, recently, like a couple of years back? What was that?
Yeah, that was amazing.
What were they celebrating? They do it once a year, don't they? What were they celebrating?
They do it once a year. That one, it was back in 2009, and that one was celebrating From Russia With Love. So it's like they have a summer barbecue, you go along, I think there's a set number of tickets, you get to meet lots of Bond alumni who were there, Honor Blackman being one that day. I had a nice chat with Madeline Smith, who's Live and Let Die, Agent Caruso, Miss Caruso from Live and Let Die. I won't go on because that was rather nice. But anyway, but it's really cool because they show you around Pinewood, so you see the gardens from Russia with Love, you know, the pre-title sequence. So you see that and various other little bits from some of the films. But you see basically where the car chase in Goldfinger happened.
Well, that's why I brought it up, because that whole chase was on between all the back buildings on the Pinewood lot, wasn't it? So you actually got to see all the alleys and stuff he was driving down.
And they are now called like Goldfinger Avenue and stuff like that. So, but yeah, no, it is really good. You can sort of see where all the cars are driving in and out, and fantastic. Yeah.
Oh, man. We're going to have to do that this year. I wonder what they're going to celebrate this year. We're going to have to do it.
So
I guess after Bond crashes the car, again, bit inept, isn't it? He ends up on the table with the laser, which again, is it more iconic than the Golden Girl? Is it less iconic? I don't know, but it's definitely up there.
I think they're the two scenes, aren't they? They're the two Goldfinger scenes, which have been copied by everyone sort of thing, and which everyone knows about, and they're both amazing. I mean, I wouldn't pick one over the other. I guess, actually, if I had... No, I best not. But I think the laser scene is just amazing. You know, it's updated from the novel, so the novel is going to be a buzzsaw, which would have been nice, but a little bit messy. Mm. In fact, well, the laser would have been messy as well, but And obviously back then, people had never seen a laser. They didn't know, they might have heard of it, but they didn't know what it looked like. They didn't know what it did. So, you know, you're at the forefront of technology as well with that sort of scene. And the tension is, you know, it's brilliant. It's so good.
I remember in that mentioning the buzzsaw in the book there, I remember there's the scene in there where the buzzsaw's heading down to Bond, and he basically tries to sort of like asphyxiate himself so he doesn't actually, he's not alive during the thing, like, so he basically tries to hold his breath enough so he passes out before the buzzsaw actually gets him, which is what they tried to do in Die Another Day when he's on the MI6 ship. Do you remember when they get him and he's all bearded and messed up before he escapes? But obviously in that film, all of a sudden he just bursts awake and fights everybody off and waltzes off the ship, which is just bollocks.
But
it has an interesting little throwback to that.
I like that. I didn't know that about the book. That's really good.
You've got the whole exchange here between Goldfinger and Bond, and you've got the you know, the "Do you expect me to talk?" I mean, again, there's no more iconic.
What does he say again? I can't remember.
He says something like, "No." I don't fancy a chat, and off you walk.
Yeah, I think that was it.
So, I mean, there it is. And it's like Bond saves himself. It could have all ended there. And it was just the fact that he heard Operation Grand Slam that is what saved him.
Goldfinger didn't care that 008 was going to replace him, did he?
No
skin
not.
Off his nose, sort of
no,
thing.
No, absolutely not.
Yeah, there's two things about this scene which I'm not entirely sure about. The first one, you know, he's meant to be lying on a slab of gold.
Mm.
It doesn't look like gold to me. It's almost got these striations in it that makes it look a bit like wood. You know how you've got like lines in wood?
I've always thought that.
Why is it not just a pure sheet of clean, smooth gold? Why these lines, they just look like, it just doesn't look right to me. When I was young, I always thought he's on wood. And obviously, when I sort of realised it's meant to be gold, it doesn't look right. It should have just been smooth sheen gold, like no sort of deviations or lines or anything in it. Just
well, that's it. I think
it's strange.
Yeah, it is weird. I've often thought that, and you can see the wood grain, can't you? You can actually see it. But I think I remember hearing in the extras that they basically had, it was a sheet of wood, and then that they just sort of glazed it over the top with a golden sheen. So it looked like gold. And then obviously the laser wasn't real. So it was like there's a guy underneath with a blowtorch kind of like just gradually kind of moving it along. And that's, you know, you see the little flame pop out the top as it's coming back. I suppose that's sort of all they could do. I'm sure they could have made it.
They could have made it look better. I'm glad.
A thicker layer of gold paint would have just done the trick.
I'm glad that you said that, because I've never said that before to anyone. I didn't know anyone's opinion on it. But seeing as you felt the same, I'm glad, because I thought it might have just been me. I don't know, but it definitely could have looked better.
Yeah.
The only other thing as well, which I think could have been done slightly better, is the editing around the laser heading towards his crotch. because there's certain scenes where towards the end it's like a centimeter away from his trousers. Then we go and see Goldfinger having a chat. Then it comes back to Bond on a long shot, sort of looking scared. Then it goes back to Goldfinger, whatever. And time within that time, it would have like gone through his trousers, sort of thing. But there are, when it cuts back, there are other scenes when it's a lot closer and you sort of see it. I think edit, there are only a couple of instances where I'm not in agreement with Hunt's editing. Some I'll talk about later on in this podcast. But that's one of them where I think just if they just change the shots around a little bit, it just would have made a bit more sense in terms of the laser and made it a bit more logical. But I mean, that is so nitpicking because it is an iconic scene and it is amazing and I do love it. So apologies if that was too much nitpicking for everyone.
No worries. So after that, he gets shot with a tranquilizer dart, wakes up on the plane.
Which is good. I like that.
Which is good. And again, there's a couple of things I want to talk about, which is comparison between the book and the movie. One of which is that Pussy Galore in the book is a lesbian. And there's it's very, very, and I imagine at the time, 1964, I imagine that wasn't sort of something that will be spoken about all that much. So there's just that one line where he's trying to charm her on the plane, and she says, you know, you can turn off the charm, I'm immune, which I guess was that little nod to that fact in the book.
Yeah.
But of course she Bond turns her at the end and changes her entire sexuality at the end, which of course he would. but I thought that was interesting that they kind of threw that in. But one thing that does make me laugh, and it's like it common in a lot of films from this period as well, is like whenever a sexy lady appears on the screen, like when her flying circus people come up, get out their planes, you have that saxophone line. It's like, which just makes me laugh. It's just like how the saxophone is perceived as this sexy instrument. It's just like, there we go. It's great.
It's a little bit sort of cheesy, isn't it? But we like it. No, I like that plane scene. It's got a lot of good stuff. I like, obviously, Galore Bond sort of dialogue is good, but it's quite cool when he goes into the back and they're doing the little spying. They look through the clock and he sort of recognizes that, and then they peek through while he's having a shave, and then he sort of recognizes. So there's quite nice little moments there, and then she's like, "Oh, you like close shaves, don't you?" And it's quite nice. I like that.
Yeah.
But he does, if you notice, when he's there, he is sitting very much on a Dr. Evil chair. He's on this black chair that's, you know, high wing backed and then cut in, and it is basically the chair that Dr. Evil uses, and it's quite quite interesting, that, I think.
It's
quite a funny looking thing.
So I suppose this kind of brings things on to the next section, which is Goldfinger's Kentucky ranch with all his horses.
Yeah,
And you've got the kind of you've got the meeting with all the gangsters, which I think is just, when you watch it, it's just funny how they're like just sort of cliche New York gangsters. It just makes me laugh, and it's like they're the most confused bunch of people in the world. I imagine they're, you know, very successful at their job. You know, they're very successful gangsters. But it's like everything Goldfinger does, they've got a question about it. It's like, what's with that trick pool table? What's that map doing over there? I don't like being cooped up like this. What is this, a merry-go-round? And it's just like, guys, just chill out, man. Let the guy say what he's going to say. It's so funny.
Yeah, it's one of these things where I love bits about this scene, and then there are other bits I'm not so sure about. The gangsters being the sort of uncertainty, but the actual set, again, another Ken Adams set, the Rumpus Room, the fact that all these things are changing for real. You've got the flipping pool table, you've got the map that comes down, you know, all these things, and I mean it's great, isn't it? It just looks so good.
I think that is the iconic Bond villain thing, is it, there's got to be a map hidden behind something in a room, and then when the map comes out, you know it's time to talk about a plan.
And great that obviously at the same time Bond, he's just snuck out of his cell, which was a bit of an interesting one in terms of how he teases the Korean to come in just by sort of disappearing. It's a bit slightly weak, I would say.
I think that guard has got to be the dumbest guard in the history of guarding. I mean, Jesus Christ almighty. Like, there he is. Bond sort of just sinks down below the thing and he immediately's like, well, I've got to go in there and see what's going on. Like, I mean, there's nowhere he could have gone, you stupid bastard. But there you go.
He got his comeuppance, so he deserved it, yeah. And then obviously he comes out and he sees the platform, and then you see him listening in, and that's quite cool, and he's writing down his notes. And then Miss Galore sort of sweeps him off his feet, and that's nice as well. I really like that. But
yeah, that is cool.
I think the speech that Goldfinger gives is brilliant. He's got the classic man has fired rockets to the moon, climb Mount Everest, you know, split the atom, achieved everything, if you know, in every field of human endeavor except climb, which is really good. And then he's obviously talking about Operation Grand Slam and doing all that. So from that point of view, I think it's amazing, and I really like it. And then it gets to the scene where everyone, you know, Solo's like, I'll take my money now. And then obviously he goes outside with Goldfinger, and then leaves it to Kish, I think his name is, or something like that, to
that's right. Yeah.
To say goodbye to the gangsters, which I've never been sad about, because they're so kind of irritating that you're almost like, yes, rooting for them to be gassed in a way, which is kind of bad, I guess. But I don't know. Yeah. Well, maybe not. I don't know. What did you think about that?
I must admit I enjoyed the part where the guy kind of gets taken away, Solo gets taken away and kind of crushed in a car. I think that's a good Bond villainy way to dispose of somebody.
Fantastic.
And then he brings the block back, and Goldfinger's like, I've got to separate my gold from the late Mr. Solo.
I love the way that you can see a gold bar within the block as well.
It's really cool. But obviously Bond's little homing beacon just completely went to waste there. There was no, you know, he was onto something there, and it completely buggered up.
Yeah.
But one of the things I do really like about this part of the film is when Goldfinger notices that, you know, they're being watched by Felix and his mate. So he's like, well, let's bring Bond out and let him know that he's safe, kind of thing.
Hmm.
And he brings old Bond out, gives him his mint julep. Is it hot enough for you? and then Bond sits down and he's like, I've been doing the numbers, because obviously he's been sitting in his cell and he's got nothing else to do.
Yeah.
And it's an interesting sort of thing about the way his mind works. And he's, I mean, for me, if I've got some downtime, I like doing fuck all. I like literally just lying there, not thinking about anything and just chilling out, right? Yeah. Whereas Bond, he's in his cell and his mind's ticking over. And he says, you know, I've been doing the numbers on the bullion job. You know, $15 billion in gold bullion weighs 10,500 tons. 60 men would take 12 days to load it onto 200 trucks, and it would be 2 hours before the army and navy and everybody else come along and make you put it back. So he's good at the old mathematics, isn't he, old Bond?
I think you could have done that as well, given, you know, if you were in a Korean cell or in a prison cell, I'm sure you'd be able to do
it. I don't know, man. I'm not good at maths at all. Like, no. I haven't counted past 10 in a long time. Like,
okay.
Yeah, I'm a bit number retarded. I don't think I could have pulled that off.
No. But, well, it was good. It was good to see him have that, because obviously we've been going on about how inept he's been in this film. So it's nice to show him able to do something.
At least
he's
good at
maths. He could be a maths teacher. Forget about spying Bond.
At least he can be.
You could be a maths teacher.
At least he can still do his numbers. It's all right. The spying game, he's not too good at this time around. But yeah, right. Which I suppose you bring it onto this, the point of, again, the difference between the book and the movie is the sense that Goldfinger's actual plot is completely different. In the sense, it's still Fort Knox. But in the book, all he wanted to do was just steal the gold, and that was it, which is pretty, you know, by the numbers plot.
And the fact that they never actually get to break into Fort Knox in the book. So they get everyone there, but they get stopped before they do. So straight away, imagine if that happened in the film. They get to Fort Knox and everyone's like, oh, you're not going in there.
Yeah,
slap wrist. And then that's how it ended. It'd be like, that'd be so uncinematic.
Yeah, completely. So it's, you know, they had to see the inside of Fort Knox, because again, nobody really ever seen it apart from, you know, the few people in the know.
Even the President of the United States isn't allowed to go in and see it, apparently.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah.
That's crazy, isn't it? But and I think this is a perfect example of the films massively improving on the foundation of the book. In the sense that, you know, the thought of going in there and making all the gold radioactive for however many years, Bond says, I can't remember how many years it is now, but like, that's
52.
Is it? Okay.
I don't know, 50 something, anyway.
57 rings
a bell. 57,
actually.
Yeah, 57, yeah.
Yeah.
No, Bond says 57 and Goldfinger says 58.
All right. How has he made that? I mean, he must be good at this. How has he made that calculation?
He's good as well.
But yeah, so that concept of radiating the gold so it's useless to increase the value. I mean, that's a genius idea. Yeah. That's something that's never been thought of or seen before.
No.
And that's a perfect example of a massive improvement over the book, which is just a straight heist, basically.
And I think, I mean, that must have either been Dick Maybaum, Paul Dane, who came up with that. I'm not sure who. I think, well, it was definitely them. But yeah, again, fantastic. You know, that has improved it immensely. I mean, that's basically what brought that film up another level, I think, because of that twist. And you don't see it coming because... Mm. You know, when he's with the gangsters, he's saying about his bank opens on Sunday and he's going to break in. You think, well, that is his plan. That's what he's planning to do. And then when you hear that line, who said anything about removing the gold? Straight away, you're like, what the f-? What? Yeah. What do you mean? And that's so good. I love it. It's brilliant.
That is a perfect twist, isn't it? That works really well. And then again, sort of after that, you get, you know, Pussy comes out in a lovely mauve trouser suit.
I do like Honor Blackman. I must say, like... She is gorgeous. She's the oldest Bond girl as well. I think she's 37. But you know, she was hot stuff. She was good.
I think I still would even to this day, to be honest with you.
Is that in case she's listening? Or
yeah, Honor, if you're listening, you know, give me a call. You've got like the tradition throughout these movies of. I'd say Bond being a little bit on the rapey side in the sense that, you know, we've established, certainly anybody who'd read the book before they went to see the film, they would have known that Pussy Galore was a lesbian. They go for a little stroll. He just casually strolls into the barn and literally forces himself on her. She is literally on her back trying to push him off. And then he's like holding her down and then bang, there he goes. And obviously she gives in and away they go and they have a little rumble in the hay.
When was the last time you used that technique then, Tom?
I don't think you're allowed to use that technique, are you? Is that a thing?
Well, that's how I've been. All of my techniques have been following what Bond's done in the early films.
I'm surprised you haven't been slapped in irons and thrown in jail, Chris. Jesus Christ almighty.
That's where I'll go wrong, I guess. No.
There we go.
No, it is a bit, you know, forceful, isn't it? And it's a bit of a strange one, that. Because earlier on in the film, you've had, you know, when he's kind of with Jill and... But she, when you see Jill with him, Jill Maston with him, she's the same boat as he is. She's happy to... She's using him exactly as he's using her for the same thing. Mm. Whereas the fact that Pussy's this... lesbian or bisexual or whatever she's sort of meant to believe, there is that little bit of rapiness coming in, which is you know, a bit strong, I guess.
Well, but I suppose after, you know, our review of Fleming last week, that is something that kind of ties in with the man himself, supposedly. So there's always exactly. that, I guess. So which brings us on to Operation Grand Slam itself. We've got the Delta 9 nerve gas from above.
What do you think about the whole Delta 9 nerve gas?
Firstly, I think it's some of the finest acting I've ever seen during the sequence where all the soldiers fall over. I mean, that's great, isn't it? I mean, it's just marching along and they all just sit down and lie down on the floor. Yeah.
I think they must have gone like through Equity to get all those and like, you know, Hollywood A-listers, right? We'll get them for...
We need some top-level actors to pull this part off. Let's get them all in, get them suited up and get them ready for the job. But I think it's funny, isn't it, because Bond says Delta 9 nerve gas is actually fatal, and Goldfinger's like, is that rumble in the hay with Pussy who switches the gas over, which I think felt like a little bit of an afterthought. It's like they just slide that line in there later going, you know, Pussy changed the gas over, by the way, and it was like, oh, that's why they woke up and didn't die. That was a funny old one. But I think, I mean, again, Ken Adam, the Fort Knox set, I mean, that's amazing, isn't it? It's just such
well, a you've got set. Even before you go into it, you've got the exterior, which was done on Pinewood, and that was Peter Lamont, so that was his very first job on Bond. He came in one day, Ken Adam was like, well, I don't know you, but I want you to do this, and then handed him exterior Fort Knox. From like, they'd obviously, I think Cubby Broccoli had he was buddies with this guy called General Rushon, or Colonel Rushon it might be. And he was basically high up in the American sort of military, and allowed them to fly over the real Fort Knox. Obviously, it's not allowed. So he gave them permission to fly at a certain level. I think it was like, I don't know what it was. And while there were obviously lots of guards while this was happening, and they were sort of saying, you know, he's too low, he's too low. And Cubby is like, oh, no, I think he's all right. And Cubby was trying to, obviously, they wanted to get as close as they could to get these photos. And they were allowed to go around the outside. And Cubby, I can't remember who he was with, but he was like, Ted Moore, the cinematographer, was taking photos. And the guy was like, oh, you can't take photos here. And Cubby was like, oh, really? I'm sorry. And he'd walk in front of the guard. So like Ted Moore could still carry on taking photos behind him, just so they could get as close to the real thing. And then obviously they gave that to Ken Adam, who sort of put the sort of dimensions, and then gave it to Pete Lamont. And then he obviously created it on the back lot. And, you know, That's awesome. It looks amazing. It looks so good. And I think the other thing that sort of heightens this scene, again, is John Barry's score. It's just like the Dawn Raid at Fort Knox cue is brilliant. It's you know, it's got the military side to it. It's got the suspense thing and the drums.
I think it's funny you mentioned that. I think the it's really interesting that talking about the score, in the sense that during the fight with Oddjob, there is just no music. All you get is that whirring of the bomb. Like, the only time when there's any sort of music is when Bond picks up Oddjob's hat to throw it back at him. And then as soon as he misses, it's like the music drops out again. You just hear that.
That's good, isn't it?
Of the bomb, which I think silence in a score is a really good tool to use. Like, it just does so much, you know.
The train fight in From Russia with Love. You've got the sound effects of the train, but you've got no music. It's just full, you know, you're hearing it all.
Yeah, I think music can sometimes be a distraction from certain things. Like, again, like there's that part at the beginning of Goldeneye when he bungee jumps, and it's like you've got music until the moment where he literally lifts off the edge of the dam, and then it's just complete silence. Yeah.
Spy Who Loved Me, when he flies off on the skis, again, it goes silent. I mean, that's the best use of probably no music ever.
Yeah, I think you're right. Is good. So you've got basically the interior set, which they described as a cathedral of gold, which I think is good. Obviously, it's actually impossible to have the gold stack that high, because gold is so soft that the top layers, the weight would crush the bottom layers and it would end up in a bloody great mess. But for cinematic purposes, I think it looks amazing. I think it's so good.
It's completely stunning. And they, in fact, Eon received a letter from the person that runs Fort Knox to congratulate their art director or production designer on his imagination after seeing the film. And it is probably the best looking set going, I guess, visually. I think it's got to be, hasn't it, with the gold everywhere. And one of the things I really loved that they did with it was when they first entered, there was Bond, obviously he's handcuffed to the bomb now, there's Oddjob and Goldfinger, and when you see Goldfinger, he looks at Bond, make sure he's still sort of handcuffed, and then you see him look at all this gold, and to him, for someone with that obsession, what he loves more than anything in the world, he's never seen as much of it, and it's just sitting there. And the temptation for him to think, oh, should we just forget about the bomb and let's just take all the gold anyway? Yeah. You know, it must have been so strong.
Yeah.
And I just love that little look that he has when he's just looking around the guys. It's great.
There's a couple of interesting points about that whole thing, is that basically after the vault door closes, and you've got the guy that's like, you know, Kish is like, don't be a hero and all that kind of stuff. And Oddjob just chucks him over the top and he dies. Like, if you think about it, Oddjob is willing to die for this cause, in the sense that he's locked in there with Bond, and he's going to do whatever it takes to let that bomb go off, even with him in there, which is pretty insane, isn't it, really, when you think about it?
Well, yeah, he's a nutter, isn't he, really? And he'll do anything for his master, I guess. And I guess, like, the fact that he is locked in there, because he didn't, you know, perhaps there was a chance they could have come out, but he didn't want to. He wanted to make sure that bomb went off. And I guess that just adds even more to how how sort of crazy he is as a villain and how sort of hardcore he is, I guess. And yeah, it's great.
Yeah, I one of the in fact, this is a talking point that we haven't mentioned yet, is that this is the first time we see the kind of the minions of the villain all with their matching uniforms on, which kind of staple later on. You know, they've got their little sort of blue overalls and the yellow sash. Now, why is it that Goldfinger has like an army of Korean minions in the middle of Kentucky? Like, what is the link there?
Yeah, I that's a very good question. I think obviously that what they're trying to say is that Goldfinger's got sort of links with Red China and China communism or Korea or, you know, whatever. So there, because he's blowing up, irradiating the gold, not only does his gold soar, but, you know, there's economic chaos in the West, so they say, which obviously apparently China or Korea or whoever in the East wants to happen because it's screwing them up. So that's the basis behind why they're in league. The fact that he's got all these like minions running around, and if he was in Korea or China and they had them there, you'd say, okay, fair enough. But the fact that he's shipped them all over to Kentucky and has got them like on his ranch, just, it's almost a bit like slavery, but for his cause. I don't know. It's strange, isn't it? It's always been a bit of a weird one for me. Yeah. Because I mean, if you look at things like in all the latter sort of Bond versus villains with lots of minions, you know, Thunderball, but you can see how that works because they're all sort of work for Spectre and the divers. Spy Who Loved Me, you know, you've got all the guys who work for Carl Stromberg, but it almost doesn't quite seem it seems okay, you can accept that, but it's just this one with Goldfinger, it does seem out of place. It does seem quite strange.
It's a bit odd, isn't it?
It is a bit odd, but there is a really cool bit, and I love it when they first, you know, they break in, and then the army obviously start sort of attacking everything. You see Goldfinger, he's got his uniform on, puts on his like army uniform, and he's got the golden gun. So the very first golden gun is in Goldfinger. He's got his golden Colt, and as soon as the army turn up at the door, Mr. Ling's there. He's like, poof, poof, goodbye, Mr. Ling, and then obviously he machine guns them, and then we don't see him until a little bit later. Yeah, so it's good. Quite cool. I like that bit.
So again, Bond, he's in the vault, and the only thing of value he's done at all so far is actually kill Oddjob. So good on him for that.
But he doesn't. The actual fight was good though, wasn't it?
The actual fight was very good. That was cool. Like, again, it's somebody who's, I would say Red Grant was evenly matched with Bond, whereas Oddjob, I would say, definitely had the advantage and was still outwitted, which is good. But again, Bond doesn't even defuse the bomb. He's got to wait for this guy to come down, and all he does is go and just flick a switch and the bomb's off. Which leads me to a point that actually I know you're not happy with, which is the inconsistency here, whereby they changed their mind, and originally the timer on the bomb was originally meant to stop at 3 seconds, but they changed it to 007 instead because, you know, it's a funny little nod. But Bond still says 3 more ticks and Mr. Goldfinger would have hit the jackpot.
So that thing I'm not actually too bothered about. That thing I think is fine. It was Harry Saltzman that came up with the idea of changing it to 007. But what I don't understand, first of all, is if they've got like a bomb with 3 numbers, why did someone not come up with that idea previously? It seems so obvious, the 007 countdown. But anyway, that's besides the point. There is something that annoys me even more, which is their editing around the countdown of the bomb. And this is, maybe I'm thinking too much about it, but there's points where, like, for instance, I think it's like 20 seconds to go or 17 seconds to go, and Leiter and the army guy and the bomb disposal expert literally just walk in at the top.
Yeah.
And in realistic terms, it would take them at least 30, possibly 40 seconds to get down to defuse a bomb. According to the timer, they've got like 20 seconds left. And I'm like, you can't do that. And there's also times where there's a clock on the bomb and it will tell you a number. And if you count down the same speed as that timer, the next time it goes back, you know, it looks as if 4 seconds has gone, but it's actually been like 15 seconds. And that's completely like illogical.
You see, this is the stuff where we need to just get out of the house more often, I think. Because
yeah, I think you have just
admitted this. And I have to admit now that I've done exactly the same thing where I've sat there and I've been like, I'm going to count those seconds and see how far they go. Yeah. And I've sat there again, get my stopwatch out, making sure it's accurate, yeah. And then being outraged that it wasn't accurate. Yeah.
Yeah. But that as an editor, is not a hard job to do. I love the fact that Peter Hunt's created the whole quick edit system, you know, and no one had ever done that before. And it creates pace and it really helped the Bond series. But the instances where it revolves around a bomb, you can't snap edit that. You can't flip with the logic of a countdown.
Yeah.
Because it just doesn't make sense.
It is what it is, isn't it?
And the same thing happens in Honor Majesty's at the end with the countdown. They're like, literally, it counts down to like zero. And then for the next 4 seconds, you see a Blofeld jump out and you see Bond jump out. But 4 seconds ago, it was already at naught.
Yeah,
and it's stuff like that. It's maybe we do need to get out. I'll get out of the house today. But you know, it's just one of those things. And I think if that had just been edited better, I would have been happier. But the fight with Oddjob, fantastic. I love the bit. In fact, there's a strange bit. You know when he actually throws a hat and Bond ducks and it hits the electric cable sort of early on. If you watch that throw is way off. He's like, it's like about 20 feet above Bond's head. It's like Bond didn't have to duck.
Yeah,
Bond could have jumped up and like waved his arm and he still would have been all right. But anyway, that fight, I think it ranks with, I don't know if I'd put it level with the Red Grant fight. I mean, it'd be very, very close, probably as good as. And then you've got the bit where he kills him with the electric thing. And the thing about that, which is really cool, well, cool in a way, is that when Harold Sakata went to hang on to the hat, the sparks that were sort of launched behind him actually burnt him. But he still wanted to hang on until Guy Hamilton sort of said cut.
Yeah.
And Guy Hamilton didn't know he was being burned and it looked so good, so he didn't say cut for ages.
Yeah.
Which is pretty brave.
The reason it looked so good is because he was being burnt to smithereens.
Yeah.
But what a tough bastard.
Yeah, exactly. That's pretty cool. And there's something just before, which I've got to mention, just before they go into the vault as well, is I love it when the army... Oddjob and Bond and the Goldfinger army sort of get out of their trucks, and he's got this auric spectrometer which is like shows the danger level, and it's so kind of 60s Batman. It's one of those things where you just think,
it's like that thing in Dr. No, isn't it, with the big wheel, and it's like danger. Love it. But then after that sequence, we come into what is now becoming a staple in the Bond series, which is a villain coming back at the end after you think it's all over. So Bond's on the plane. Goldfinger comes out of the cockpit, and again one of my favorite quips from the movie is where Bond looks up to him and says, "Ah, Goldfinger, are you having lunch at the White House too?" which does make me laugh. You've got the ultimate climax, the little fight, Goldfinger getting sucked out of the window, which I think we all know Goldfinger is far too hefty to be sucked out of a plane window, but for cinematic purposes I guess that kind of works. And then you've got the climax with Honey and Bond underneath the parachute in the Pinewood Gardens, getting busy, which is the only time Connery's Bond doesn't end the film in a boat or hanging off the back of a plane or at sea, basically, which is quite interesting, but a similar concept nonetheless.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's a cool little idea with Goldfinger taking over the plane and the fight, and again, the golden gun comes out. There are moments where it does look a bit dodgy. You've got everything flying out the window, and it doesn't quite look right. You've got the model plane flying like this, like up and down. You're like, it doesn't quite look right.
Blatantly a model as well, yeah.
Yeah, blatantly a model. There's a couple of things that, you know, but then again, I suppose if you can overlook that, it's still, it's a cool way for
Goldfinger to go sort of thing. Yeah. And I don't know whether he does his little quip, Pussy Galore's like, where's Goldfinger? And he's playing his golden harp sort of thing. And he does a nice one earlier with Old Job, he blew a fuse sort of thing. Yeah. So we're getting the one-line quips about the deaths as well in the village, which is a good staple to have as well. So that's cool. Yeah, and then, like you said, and then they end up on the with a parachute which you and I have both seen.
Oh, yes. That was a Bond in Motion, wasn't it?
It was, nice orange and white parachute. I think that's something that we possibly could have, if we really wanted to, snuck underneath like our jumper and walked out of it. What do you think?
I reckon we could have definitely rolled it up. Yeah, stuck it up. Yeah. I could have pretended I was pregnant or at least morbidly obese. And then we could have got away with that. But so there it is. That's Goldfinger reviewed. So what's your post-watching thoughts? I'm going to tell you what mine are right now. Okay. Are you excited about
it? Go for it. Yeah,
My thoughts are, it's brilliant, right? It's a massive step above the previous two. It has basically set the template for most of Bond moving forward and the action movie itself in the broader genre.
The genre, yeah.
But for me, it isn't quite the Bond from the books of it's not Bond. It's not the Bond from Russia with Love or Doctor No. He's not being so much of a detective and doing that kind of cool down to earth spy stuff. It's getting into the realms of sort of a bit more comic booky and a bit more fantastical, which is good in its own way. It's just kind of different. And this just movie is about 100 times bigger than the previous two put together, like on a scale. And it's the first time you see Bond in so many different locations. You've got London, you've got Miami, you've got Switzerland, you've got Kentucky and Fort Knox and all these amazing locations. And I love it, but I think if I'm really going to get my Bond on, I think and really get to the core of the character, it's not a good example of that, I don't think. Whereas something like, for me, Casino Royale or Honor Majesty's or even From Russia with Love is, I think. How do you feel?
Well, pretty much mirrors my thoughts as well. Like we've been saying, so many iconic things. I think there are certain things that definitely kind of let it down, but it set the standard for the Bond formula as we know it. It is a fantastic film. I think it's one that I definitely will need a break before I watch again. I almost feel as if I've seen it a bit too much at the moment. But, brilliant film, fantastic. For me, I'd still put From Russia with Love above it, just because I think From Russia with Love's pretty flawless.
I agree with that. Now, I used to always have Goldfinger sitting on the top of the Connery films, but after revisiting them, I've definitely got From Russia up there at the top at the moment.
Yeah, From Russia and Thunderball, good. But yeah, no, great film. Good to watch it again. And
Okay, so you know what time it is now, don't you, Chris?
It's exciting time. That's what it is.
It's exciting time. It's time for Bond facts.
Oh yeah!
I'm going to read off five amazing Bond facts. How many Bond facts have you got for us today, Chris?
I have 007 Bond facts.
Ooh. Okay, so my Goldfinger-related Bond facts are, number one, it was a conscious decision to have Goldfinger wear something yellow or golden throughout every scene, even when he wears the U.S. Army Army uniform, he has his golden revolver. Plus, of course, he's also ginger too. So that's always...
Was that a casting decision?
I think it must have been, yeah. In fact, on the Blu-ray, there's some footage of another guy screen testing for Goldfinger, whose name I forget. I did have that written down.
Theodore Bickle.
Theodore Bickle, good stuff. And he's fucking awful.
But they make him look ginger. Orange, don't they?
Yeah. He's got like orange hair and like weird little specky glasses on. Number two. Originally, Bond's reply of, I must be dreaming, when Pussy introduces herself on the plane, was, I know you are, but what's your name? Which I thought was brilliant. And they
that is pretty suggestive. That's good. Yeah. That's good.
Number three, Gert Frobe actually spoke German throughout the majority of his scenes, which makes it even more crazy how good that dubbing is, because I didn't even know he was dubbed until the last sort of recent years. But he's actually speaking German throughout his scenes, which is just mental. Number four, The actual Fort Knox vault door they used in the movie is now located at the Bank of the West in Los Altos, California. That's got to be worth a visit. Ooh. Not that it lets in.
But, yeah, just to see. I wonder if the code is still the same.
Yeah. and then lastly, the revolving number plate on the DB5 was Guy Hamilton's idea after he received a lot of parking tickets. We revealed that one throughout the beginning of this episode, but hey-ho, we can live with that.
Hey-ho. Cool. Okay, so here's my Bond 007 facts. So number one fact, the idea for Goldfinger came to Ian Fleming after he visited a health spa called Eaton Hall, whereby he was speaking to a gold broker who educated him about the whole process. So
very nice. I wonder if that spa's still open. We'll have to go there and...
yeah, if it is, yeah, definitely. Bond fact two, Gert Frobe was nervous about the scene where they gassed the gangsters because of the sort of connotations with the gas chamber and the World War II.
Of course, him being German as well.
Of him being German. Mm. And actually, it was initially banned in Israel because they thought that he was a Nazi sympathizer. And it took a Jewish man to come out to say that he actually helped him and his family and saved their lives during the war. And then obviously it was then permitted. So that's a
good
nice
old
story.
Gert, a villain good with a heart. Gert.
A villain with a heart, indeed. Bond fact three. Well, actually, this is one we've mentioned, but I still think it's worth mentioning again. Sean Connery did not step foot in America at any point during this film. And if you think how much the film is set in America, that is crazy. That is
it's
amazing.
Pretty cool, isn't it? Yeah, interesting.
Bond fact four, Mr. Ling, who is played by Burt Kwok, is also seen in this as a Spectre agent in the volcano in You Only Live Twice. And he's also well known as Kato from the Pink Panther films.
Absolutely.
Number five, this is quite an interesting one. After viewing the film, the US censors were really anxious about the sex involved, the sexual connotations in the film, but didn't care about any of the violence. Mm. Whereas the British censors were really worried about the amount of violence in the film, but they didn't care about any of the sexual connotations. So completely reversed. And
that is funny, isn't it? You'd almost think that would be the other way around with the old stiff upper lip Britishness, but they didn't mind a bit of sexiness, but
didn't like the violence. Unusual, number six, this is an interesting one as well. Michael G. Wilson, our good buddy, obviously, he on the film was assistant director. He was also a T-boy. He doubled as one of the Koreans. And he also ended up forgetting Oddjob's hat one day. So they were on set and he had to drive for miles to go back to get this hat. He came back on set with a hat and Guy Hamilton had gave him a big sort of boot up the arse and stuff and sort of had a go at him. Obviously, they wasted time. And poor Michael Wilson was a bit like, you know, is this what happens on all movies? And Hamilton was like, yes, of course it is, you know. So I quite like the fact that his first foray into films was forgetting Oddjob's hat and getting, like, you know, beaten for it.
That
and now
incredible.
And now he's, like, running the whole franchise with Babs. So that's quite cool. And finally, my 007 fact is that Guy Hamilton paid all the soldiers, the obviously A-star Hollywood actors that we were talking about, paid them $10 and a beer. So that on the first whistle, they had to look up at a certain position in the sky. And on the second whistle, they all dropped down dead. So for $10 and a beer, they were happy to oblige.
Very nice.
They're my Bond facts.
Cool stuff. There we go. Okay, so we best round up our trivia questions from the beginning of today as well. My question is, what type of golf ball does Goldfinger use?
Now, this is a very good one. I know that Bond uses a pinfold hearts, and Goldfinger uses a Schlesinger 7.
It's a Schlesinger 1.
Oh! He uses a Schlesinger 1.
But,
and
Schlesinger
7's the other ball.
The way I phrase that could be, because he does use the Schlesinger 7, unbeknownst.
Well, and he uses both, doesn't he?
So there you go. Right. Half a point.
Okay. And my trivia, how does Bond take his mint julep?
I can't remember. Fruity.
It's sour mash and not too sweet.
Ah, very nice.
Is that how you took yours in New Orleans?
They just gave me a mint julep. I didn't know what the fuck I was doing, to be honest. They just gave me one. I was like,
what did it taste like? I've never had one.
It was very nice. It was sort of...
minty?
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
Julepy.
Yeah. Yeah. A bit julepy with a bit of mint in there. Yeah, it's a flavour I can't really describe. There's not something I could say that it's like. But it was really nice. I was really surprised. Yeah. I'm not much of a drinker for that kind of stuff. But I was like, oh, yeah, I could have definitely had a few of those. That was really nice, yeah. But,
cool.
But there we go. Okay, so to round up, it's quote time.
Quote
so,
time.
So I'll perform my quote from last week's episode.
Okay, let's go for it.
Which is this. Gotta get into the role. All right, okay, here we go. Where is he? What's he doing?
Oh, you know, I think this one has me stumped.
Really?
I really can't think. Do you mind saying it one more time?
Certainly. Where is he? What's he doing?
Oh, I think that's got me. All I can think of is someone saying that about Bond. But I don't know if that's true.
Well, you've definitely got that part right. Funnily enough,
yeah.
I got a little message on Facebook with one of our listeners, Mr. Stephen Bain, saying that he immediately got it as soon as he heard last week's episode.
So wow. Got it correctly. Well done, Stephen. He's obviously got a better ear for it than me.
Yeah.
Go for it.
Is it's M at the end of A View to a Kill while they're watching through the eyes of Snooper.
Excellent. Station. Nice. Yeah. That's a good one. I kind of pictured that scenario, you know, of Roger at the end. It happened to a lot of them, but I couldn't remember which one. That's a good one. Okay, so time for my quote for this week, which is going to be, you have a nasty habit of surviving.
I like that.
Yeah, is that right?
I know who it is. I've got it in one.
Cool. But should I say it one more time for the audience?
I think let's do it. So, yeah, let's do it.
Okay, I'll try and get it in better. You have a nasty habit of surviving.
Nice. I like it.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah, that's good. Cool. Obviously, Chris will reveal the answers to that question in next week's episode, which leads us on to what is next week's episode? Let them know, Chris.
Next week's episode is a really good one. It is going to be dedicated to Q and the gadgets.
There's lots to be talked about there. I can't wait to record that one. That's going to be good.
It's going to be good fun.
Yeah, good stuff. I can already think of my top few gadgets, and I can definitely know what my worst few gadgets are. So it'll be interesting to talk that through.
Yeah.
All right. Cool. So that about rounds up today's episode. We've been talking about Goldfinger. Next up is the gadgets of Q. So James Bond Radio will return with Q and the gadgets of Bond. I've been Tom Sears.
I've been Chris Wright.
And we'll see you next time. See you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye now.